different, try different types of models, maybe using an ear pump to inject the bacteria and so on. So we're really in the very first stage here. But possibly it could be a difference as well.
Okay, you have a couple more. Let's start down there.
Thank you very much. I was just wondering if you know anything about how long it takes for the adaptive immune response to peak and whether the probability of having a chronic infection, whether there's a higher probability of the infection becoming chronic if the onset is long.
So in tuberculosis, it's delayed, as I said, and it's very common that it is a chronic infection here. So I do think that if there's a delay, that the bacteria is more able to be establish itself, and therefore not risking to being cleared so early on. And I think that's a really benefit for the bacteria. Does that answer your question?
Okay, we have another question up there.
I just wanted to also ask about the virulence of the MCV, particularly since you use two different strains.
Mm-hmm.
If there's any measurements of the virulence that might differ between strains?
So you mean between wild type and our mutant bacteria?
Yeah, I mean, how fast they propagate.
Yeah, so there's definitely a difference, I think. So the wild type bacteria, so if we infect in vitro with wild type compared to Delta or the unarmed mutant bacteria, the cells that are infected with wild type are more likely to die. So it's definitely more virulent. So our mutant is a weakened form, basically, without lacking the virulence factor.
Okay, and since we have a little more time in this session, I'm going to give one last question to Marcus in the front row.
So I have a bit of a silly question. So when you inject the mice with the tuberculosis vaccine, do you ever have an instance where the mouse doesn't have any tuberculosis left when you investigate?
So if we can't find any bacteria, for instance? No, not so far. But so in the very beginning, we were having trouble learning how to do IV injections, and we once didn't do so well, and we only injected very, very little volume, and we could still see some bacteria. So that's pretty good. So we were planning to look at this as an uninfected animal, but we could see bacteria. So even if we inject very, very little, they are not uninfected.
Thank you very much, Una. Thanks for a nice talk. Una and John exchange the microphone, and John gets his presentation ready. I'm gonna just tell you that there's been a little bit of a change in the program. You're gonna have two
slides
instead of three, and that is because somebody making the schedule messed up and put another name on there. I don't know who it was, just so you know what to expect. Yes, as I said, next up we have John, and when I googled John Waller a day ago or two, I found an American Christian contemporary music artist, and I checked him out, and it wasn't my cup of tea, but if anybody likes that music, you're welcome to check it out. Today, however, we have a different John, a more related John.
You don't know that.
Doing something that is a lot more interesting to all of us. He works with damselflies, and he more specifically looks at how they are selected based on, I think he's going to talk about thermoregulatory systems today and how selection in damselflies works, right? Something along the line. I'll let him tell you more.
Yeah, it's not about damselflies, but I think I wrote that in the abstract, but it's very similar.
You wrote that in his abstract.
That's the abstract. and that Christian recording artist, I've been trying to get above him in Google.
Yes, he did.
Oh.
At least in my Google.
Oh, maybe. Okay. Okay. So I will be talking about sort of thermo regulatory topics, but not in damselflies, but in fruit flies. So first, this was a collaborative project involving several bachelor students and two PIs, Jessica Abbott and Eric Svensson, who happened to be my co-supervisor and supervisor. So I just want to thank them in advance, because these bachelor students are the ones that did most of the work and a lot of the planning of these experiments. So if there's anything wrong, it's their fault. So it's predicted that 40% of lizard species will go extinct by 2080. That's a lot of lizard species. That's a huge amount of lizard species. Maybe too many lizard species, right? Maybe this is an overestimate of the number of lizard species that will go extinct. Perhaps this is a too dire prediction for the number of lizard species. Why is that? Perhaps some of these populations will actually evolve their way out of harm. Perhaps they'll adapt to whatever new environment we're creating for them. So this is sort of what's represented in this graph here. At some point in the past. No. So we have this like initial environmental stress, and then we get this like declining population. But meanwhile, in the background, we have increasing favorable allele frequencies. So in this scenario, our population is first suffering because of some environmental stress, maybe global warming, and then eventually gets out of the nosedive because it's able to adapt to its new environment. I think that's pretty straightforward. So what are the ingredients that we need in order to get this adaptation? While it's necessary to have like phenotypic variation in some trait, let's say thermal performance, that's not a sufficient element in order to get an evolutionary response. We need actually genetic variation, and we actually need additive genetic variation, which I've represented with this GA. Because this additive genetic variation is actually the genetic variation that will be inherited to the next generation. So obviously, if there's no heritability, it doesn't matter how much selection you actually have on whatever trait you're trying to select on, you will get no evolutionary response. If all your variation in your phenotype is due to environmental noise or some other factor, then you will not get an evolutionary response. So if we're going to investigate sort of whether a lot of populations are going to go extinct from some environmental stress, we have to investigate, do they have the standing genetic variation in their populations in order to make some sort of adaptive response? So maybe it's 15% of lizard species rather than 40. Could be 15. Okay, so there is, while I'm giving you this optimistic message about maybe it's less than 40% of lizard species going extinct, there is also reason to be pessimistic still, because adaptation in thermal traits might be particularly low. In a lot of organisms, we see a thermal performance curve that looks like what I'm showing in the graph. So we get this sort of slow incline up to an optimal performance, and then a sharp decline in performance as you increase temperature past a certain sort of critical temperature. I think this is pretty intuitive and kind of what you would expect, but it does sort of imply that thermal traits are not like other traits. Thermal traits are not like body size, which in a lot of species seem to have a sort of unbounded reaction to like selection. So this is how you would sort of measure this in a lizard. I know I'm talking a lot about lizards, but I'm actually not gonna, I realize this, I have a huge amount of lizard examples, but this talk's not actually about lizards. It just so happens that a lot of work is done on lizards. So bear with me. So you would measure this. I'm going to use this as an analogy later. Anyway, so this lizard sort of, we could test its thermal performance by running it on a treadmill here under different temperatures, and then we would get a sort of thermal performance curve like what I showed you in the previous graph. Okay. So there are other examples of why we might think that evolving a new environmental niche, a new thermal performance curve, might be exceptionally hard, harder than, say, another trait. If we look at the worldwide distribution of salamanders, for example, they only exclusively occupy these temperate zones, which I find a little bit shocking. Like, I actually didn't know this before I looked it up, and if there's any salamander people in the room, please speak up now, because I'm taking this graph as ground truth. But there are no salamanders in the Amazonian basin. That's a little bit suspicious, right? Why no salamanders in the Amazonian basin? There's no, seemingly no geographic boundaries, nothing really keeping salamanders from invading this sort of tropical environment, wet, moist, tropical environment, perfect for a salamander. So this sort of implies that thermal niches are special. They're very difficult to evolve a new sort of thermal niche, which might imply that genetic variation in such a niche, in such a trait, would be low. So yeah, I just bring up this example that obviously salamanders have evolvability in other traits, such as body size. So this is a 45 kilo salamander found in China. So I mean, this is an extreme example, but obviously a trait like body size is much more evolvable than, let's say, a trait like thermal performance. So obviously thermal performance might be a special trait, and there might be still reason to be pessimistic about the evolvability of thermal performance. Okay, so how will we measure, how should we measure genetic variation in thermal performance? The lizard example I showed you before, I can almost be sure that they did not know that lizard's genotype in that picture. So, and typically that is the case, that we don't know the genotype of the individual that we're measuring. So it's difficult to attribute what any variation you see in a phenotype to genetic variation. It could be environmental variation or some other, I guess, yeah, it could be environmental variation or some measurement error even. That could be what you're measuring. So there exists a set of clonal lines that sort of act as a, without getting into too much detail, I think intuitively, this is the population that we used. Intuitively, you can think of these lines as a sort of population where we know all the genotypes of each individual. There are a set of inbred lines, 200 inbred lines, that are derived from a population in North Carolina where we know the genotype of every individual. So we used this population as a sort of fix to the problem of not knowing the genotype of individuals typically. So as I'm saying, like intuitively, for the next few slides I present, you can sort of think about that we're just sort of sampling from a population of fruit flies in North Carolina where we actually know the genotype of each individual. I think that's has the most interpretive value. Okay, so we were trying to investigate what is the genetic variation in thermal performance. So we need to construct thermal performance curves for each of our sort of individuals in this genetic, like in this population from North Carolina. So we picked two traits. We picked mating rate, and we also picked this sort of locomotion assay, which is obviously very analogous to what people have done with like lizards on a treadmill. So this is sort of a fly treadmill where the flies are running up the side of the bottle in different temperatures. So we can reconstruct a thermal performance curve for each of our lines, each of our individuals. Okay, so those are our two traits. So if we look at the thermal performance curve for the whole population, so this is in aggregate over all the individuals in the population, we see this sort of pattern as we'd expect from other studies where we have this sort of slow incline and then we reach an optimum, and then it sort of drops off gradually. We see that locomotion is obviously perhaps like a less drastic decline than, this is the one on the left. Locomotion has this like less drastic decline than perhaps mating rate. But we see a quite drastic decline in mating rate after a certain temperature. But that's not the interesting sort of thing here. It would be more interesting if we found sort of individual variation in thermal performance curves. Because this individual variation would indicate to us that there is standing genetic variation for this sort of curves, and therefore there might be some hope that a Drosophila population exposed to an environmental stress would be able to evolve a new thermal optimum or a new maybe max tolerance threshold. We don't really see that in our data. So this display here is each of our sort of individuals from the population, each of their thermal performance curves in terms of mating rates. So how many mates each of these individuals were able to get at a certain temperature after 10 minutes. There, you can see some variation. There's some like suspicious examples like 7:30, but you can see that there's quite low confidence on these points, which might be driving this sort of, it looks like 7:30 actually does perform better in higher temperatures. But overall, we were not able to sort of detect a statistical effect. So it really implies that there might be low genetic variation for this particular trait. And so there might not be a lot of evolvability in thermal performance in fruit flies. Okay, so do we just have low power? I think that this is probably an unlikely explanation. We have a lot of replicates for each line, and we can actually put a lower bound on sort of the reaction to temperature in after 10 minutes, like per degree Celsius, and it's very low number. So this is, of course, a lower bound, so the actual number could be much lower. So whatever variation there is, if it does exist, might be very small. Okay, so that's what we found in our population. Does this sort of match up with what other people have been seeing in other Drosophila populations? Well, there's one example, Drosophila subobscura, which its native range is here in Europe, but it only occupies these sort of temperate regions here in Europe. Well, I mean, all of Europe is temperate, but mostly it's living in these temperate regions here in Europe. And then when it invaded North and South America, it's only been able to establish itself in these sort of temperate regions here in, like, up the Oregon coast in the northwest United States, and then down in these sort of temperate regions in South America. So we have an example of a fruit fly that seems to have low evolvability in sort of its thermal niche. There are counterexamples. Populations in Africa are more viable at warm temperatures than temperate populations, so these populations in Africa actually like do better in warmer temperatures, which sort of would imply that some evolution took them to that point. And also warm adapted populations in India apparently have higher levels of desiccation resistance and melanism compared to cold adapted populations. So there might be still some hope. So I think the question is still open whether sort of fruit flies or insects in general have a high evolvability in this thermal performance. Okay, so basically in our experiment we were unable to detect some significant genetic variation in thermal performance. There's some things that we didn't do, which maybe can be addressed in the questions. We did not test female fitness, and we raised all our fruit flies at 25 degrees Celsius, which in some studies it seems that developmental temperature has a lot to do with how well your actual like thermal optimum ends up being into when you become an adult fruit fly. Yeah, so that's all I have prepared. I'll take that.
Thank you, John. Wasn't dental flies, it was fruit flies in
yes.
Lizards.
Yep.
Got that wrong. But thanks for a nice talk. And it's time for questions now. Hands up.
I gave a bagel meeting about this like a few days ago. Oh, here we go.
There we go. Howdy.
Since you said with the thermal adaptation or the thermal optimum curve that it was obvious that it would have a quick drop after the optimum, I didn't get that. Why is it intuitive or obvious that the drop after the optimum would be quick?
I guess you're right. Like, I guess it's not completely intuitive that it should be a quick drop, but I guess it's intuitive that there should be some optimum. You don't expect bacteria or whatever to live on the sun or something. But I mean, I don't know why it's intuitive. To me, it's intuitive. I guess it's up to the person. I guess protein degeneration is some sort of hard constraints. I guess that would be the intuitive reason. But I guess that'd probably be why you'd expect that.
Anyone else? Questions? Okay, and I have one more. You were talking about lizards before and how you use a treadmill to measure their activity?
Yeah, not me personally, but others.
That's how you do it?
Yeah.
Generally do it? How do you do it in Drosophila? Measure a lot harder, I guess.
Yeah, so the Drosophila have this like habit of just sort of crawling up to the top of whatever they're in. So that's what we did with that. With our fruit fly lines, actually, is we just sort of, you can just sort of stamp them down, and then they will want to crawl up to the top of whatever there. And so that's how, it's kind of like, that's their treadmill, is just the two. So you don't need a little mini fruit fly treadmill, you just need a two. So they're much easier than lizards, actually, to work with. Maybe this will become a new model system, fruit flies versus over lizards, because we need, this field is dominated by like birds and lizards and not a lot of like insects, and so maybe this Drosophila system will replace these sort of other model systems.
Okay, so Drosophila is on the rise.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Perfect. So if there's no more questions, I guess we're gonna, oh yes, now they come. There we go.
The idea that subspecies might become extinct because of these problems, that's one alternative, but the other alternative might be simply that a lot of these species change their distributions. So if we're talking about climate change, for instance, which I guess is the main thing you're thinking about, then some species will just simply move to cooler environments. Fish that live in temperate waters will go to more towards a higher latitude, and maybe that's the case for terrestrial animals as well. Is that a possibility? Are we only faced with extinction, or could we just be faced with a changing distribution of where species exist?
So that's 100% correct. The 40% figure that I gave for the lizards is quite a controversial figure, as far as I know. I don't know a lot about that 40% figure, but there are multiple roads that will save you from extinction, and there are multiple reasons to think that that 40% figure is an overestimate, which is something that maybe ExxonMobil would be happy to hear about, but I'm sure there are other like complicated reasons why you wouldn't want to change your species distribution. They might not all go extinct, but there are probably other consequences to changing species distributions and things like that. You're 100% correct. You could also just sit where you are and like sort of behaviorally change what you're doing. If you're a fruit fly or a lizard, you can just sort of it's not going to be hot every day, right? I mean, just change your activity patterns, something like that. Yeah, so you're 100% correct. We're just investigating sort of one piece of possible reasons why that 40% figure might be an overestimate.
Thank you, John.
Yeah.
That was all. And that was the last full talk, long talk, or 15-minute talk we had.